Okay, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والحمد لله رب العالمين. Okay, so last week we were discussing Ibrahim alayhi salam, the great founder of this religion, the Siddiq of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Khalil of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what we were witnessing was a prophet in his youth challenging the tradition of his forefathers. A prophet who was a symbol of courage, intellectual and moral courage and bravery. We spoke about that. We spoke about the two courages. And this man, Ibrahim alayhi salam, who was in his youth, we see him ready to stand and speak for the truth no matter what the personal consequences might be. And so he's a man of sidq. He's a man of internal sidq, internal truth and external truthfulness. And he's a man who was to walk the Middle East with only one concern on his mind: how to make his Rabb happy. You know, he was a man who wanted to sacrifice everything he had for the happiness of his Lord, his Rabb. The happiness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was more precious to him. And this is the Millah of Ibrahim. The Millah of Ibrahim is Hanifiyah, to turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to turn to God and to turn away from everything else. And this is what the salah is. When you do your salah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it in such a way where you're forced to turn from everything else. You can't eat, you can't drink, you can't talk, and you're facing Allah, you're facing the Qibla, you're facing, and you stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the Millah of Ibrahim. And we have been named after the Millah of Ibrahim. The Millah of Ibrahim is Islam. And Allah the Quran says Ibrahim, his way was Islam, his way was submission. And Allah called this religion Islam. And we've been commanded to follow this Millah. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was commanded to follow this Millah. And ittabi' millata Ibrahima hanifa. O Prophet of Allah, follow the Millah of Ibrahim. And really this is the foundation, the core, the essence of this religion. The Millah of Ibrahim, the one who founded and was to spend his life explaining to people what this, the essence and the spirit of this religion is. The spirit of submission to Allah, of sidq, of courage, of sacrifice in every moment of our life. And to repeat the dhikr, the dhikr of la uhibbu al-afirin, that I do not love those things which set. This was what Ibrahim said, which is another way of saying la ilaha illallah. La uhibbu al-afirin, that I do not love anything which sets, whether it be material wealth, worldly goods, that you say, I don't love that. And really, if we can get to a point in our lives where this statement of Ibrahim alayhi salam is deep in our hearts, where this statement of Ibrahim alayhi salam, you know, whatever we do, we are thinking about it. It's a very, very powerful state to be in. So this is the message of Ibrahim, which we talked about, and inshallah we're going to carry on talking about. And I mentioned last week also that, you know, that fear often has a control over people, such that it makes them, and shaitan is the one who instills this fear, and it makes them do things which they wouldn't normally do. And fear also is something that if it enters in your heart and it dominates you and it starts to control you, it can make you do things against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's will. And so when you become like Ibrahim, then you are able to conquer this fear. And you're able to say to yourself that I don't care about this fear. What I care about more is about Allah's pleasure. And this fear may be the fear of the unknown, it may be fear of loss of wealth, it can be fear of shame, it can be fear of emotional pain, fear of the future, it can be many, many types of fear. you know, in fear of, you know, humiliation, can be anything really. But when you understand لا أحب الآفلين, and when you become intellectually courageous and you become morally courageous, then really you're able to overcome this fear. This is what we need. What we need to get to is a position where we're able to conquer fear. And then you let Allah take care of your future, just like Ibrahim did. And what a glorious future he had. And Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was his future. The Quran was his future. This was his legacy. So have courage, and Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala will never let you down. And this is why, but this courage that Ibrahim had was a courage that came from the love of Allah and the love of other people. It's a loving courage. It's the courage of mothers. The courage of Maryam, the courage of Asiya, not the courage of angry people. That's the courage of cowardice. It's a courage of love. And this is why he speaks to his father the way he does. He says, Ya Abad, oh my dear father. So let's repeat the verses that we said last week. إِذْ قَالَ لِأَبِيهِ يَا أَبَدِي لِمَ تَعْبُدُ مَا لَا يَسْمَعُ وَلَا يُبْصِرُ وَلَا يُغْنِي عَنْكَ شَيْئًا. Oh my dear father, why do you worship what can't hear, can't see, and can't benefit you at all? يَا أَبَدِي إِنِّي قَدْ جَاءَنِي مِنَ الْعِلْمِ مَا لَمْ يَأْتِكَ فَاتَّبِعْنِي أَهْدِكَ صِرَاطًا سَوِيًّا. Oh my dear father, indeed there has come to me knowledge. I have received knowledge which has not come to you. So follow me, I will guide you to the straight path. Ya Abad, O my dear father, my beloved father, لا تعبد الشيطان, don't worship shaitan. إن الشيطان كان للرحمن عصيا. O my dear father, indeed shaitan is disobedient to the Rahman, disobedient to the one who loves everybody. Ya Abad, O my beloved father, إني أخاف أن يمسك عذاب من الرحمن فتكون للشيطان وليا. Oh my dear father, I fear lest a chastisement, a punishment, an عذاب from الرحمن, from the merciful, from the most gracious before thee, comes to you. فتكون للشيطان وليا. And then you will become close to shaitan. You will become next to shaitan. You will become a friend of shaitan. So Ibrahim says, I fear. Inni akaf. I'm worried. And this is a sincere concern from Ibrahim alayhi salam. And this is a good lesson for us. Because whenever you try to teach anybody, whether it's your children, whether it's your brothers or sisters, whether it's friends, we should have this sincerity and this concern for people. We must feel that we deeply care about them. And that's why we say what we say and do what we do. So we should have, as believers and as Muslims and as du'at, a concern and a fear for everybody that we meet. A sincerity, a love, a true love, you know, a true nusr, a true sincerity. This is a you know, very, very important quality to have. And so he's saying to his father, oh my father, you still have time, you can change your ways. If you don't, I fear you'll be cursed and be next to shaitan. Before I taught you, you might have had an excuse. Maybe you didn't know, but now guidance has come. Now that guidance has come, punishment must also come if you don't accept the guidance. You know, punishment can come from anybody. But when punishment comes from the mother, it means that the punishment that comes from the mother, it means that it's really deserved. You know, mothers don't hate their children. If they do, it means that that person really is very mean. And so this is why Ibrahim is saying, عَذَابْ مِنَ الرَّحْمَانِ. Because, you know, Ar-Rahman is somebody who loves you more than your mother loves you. Ar-Rahman, if Ar-Rahman punishes you, it means that what you've done is very, very mean. You know, some people, they say, you know, but non-Muslims are good people too. Why should they be punished? But are they really good? You know, if your mother did everything for you and then you reject your mother, is that good? Isn't that the meanest thing in the world? It's because we don't understand, we don't appreciate how dirty this sin is, how dirty the sin of kufr and shirk is. Really, it's a very, very dirty sin. You know, it's worse than somebody who, after their mother having done everything and sacrificed everything for them, grows up and then rejects and then turns their back on their mother and doesn't do anything for them. It's worse than that. So doing shirk and kufr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is meant. So عَذَابٌ مِنَ الرَّحْمَانِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala takes care of us. But for us to turn around and to say that I don't recognize, you know, I don't know if some of you saw this video by Stephen Fry. You know, one of the brothers, Brother Amin, sent it to me. You know, where he was, where somebody asked him, this Irish Catholic asked him, what would you say when you were at the pearly gates? If you were at the pearly gates, meaning, you know, that's what they called the gates of heaven. And he said, and he became, you know, angry. He became angry because what I would say is, how dare you to God? This is what I would say to God. How dare you? You allow cancer, you know, for a child. How dare you do such thing? That's wrong. That's the kind of language he was using. I was online. It's really, you know, it makes you really, really scared, actually. It's frightening the way he was talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, you can't, you know, so somebody who's brought you into this world, has given you everything, and because of whom you live, and because because of whom you eat, you know, through his rizq and through his rahmah, this is how you, subhanAllah, really, you know. So these people, they don't do shukr, you know, thankfulness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Also, another thing that we take from this verse is that it's from the rahmah of Allah, it's from the mercy of Allah, that evil which has no hope of reform and which only can increase others in misguidance does not remain. It's from the mercy of Allah that it doesn't remain. Because if it remained, it would misguide other people. And this is why Nuh alayhi salam, he says in Surah Nuh, he says, وَقَالَ نُوح رَبِّ لَا تَذَرْ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ دَيَّارًا. This is the dua that Nuh alayhi salam made after 950 years calling his people to Islam. And this is when it's allowed to make this dua, after 950 years. Not as we do, make dua against people and curse them before we even call them. That's not allowed. It's allowed when you do what Nuh did and what Ibrahim did, calling people, trying to guide people, and then you can allow to do what Nuh did. La Rabbi, O my Lord, la tadhar ala al-ardi min al-kafirin dayyara. O my Lord, leave not on the earth anybody who denies the truth. Min al-kafirin dayyara. إِنَّكَ إِن تَذَرْهُمْ. Indeed, if you leave them, يُضِلُّوا عِبَادَكَ, they will lead your slaves astray. وَلَا يَلِدُوا إِلَّا فَاجِرًا كَفَّارًا. And they will not give birth. They will not give birth to anyone except a fajir, kafar, an ungrateful, ingrate, a fajir, a wicked person. He knew this because he'd been calling them for so long, for 1,000 years. رَبِّ اغْفِرْ وَلِوَالِدَيَّ وَلِمَنْ دَخَلَ بَيْتِيَ مُؤْمِنًا وَلِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ وَلَا تَزْدِ الظَّالِمِينَ إِلَّا تَبَارًا. O my Lord, forgive me and my parents and whoever enters my house as a believer and the believers and the women believers. وَلَا تَزْدِ الظَّالِمِينَ إِلَّا تَبَارًا. And don't increase the evildoers except in destruction. So this was the dua of Nuh alayhi salam after so many years. And he made that dua because now it had become clear that these people are never going to believe. And these people, even their children will be kuffar. And so this is why he made this dua. And so it's from the rahmah of Allah that people like that are taken away from the earth because their purpose of creation doesn't remain. Because we know that the reason why Allah created us is to worship Him. You know, that's why we've been created. Allah, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. That's why we're here. So if we are people who don't fulfill the reason of why we, of our creation, then what's the point of us being on the earth? And even if we stayed, other people would lose their purpose of creation, and our children would lose their purpose of creation, then there is no maslaha, there is no benefit for us remaining on this earth. There is no benefit that remains. So this is why Nuh alayhi salam, he made that dua. And it's from the rahmah of Allah that adab comes to these people. You know, here, you know, just like we learned in Surah Al-Kahf, that, you know, some people, Stephen Fry, the same person, his argument was basically the classic argument that we mentioned, I think we mentioned last week, the classic argument of the problem of evil. You know, they say, how can evil exist? You know, how can suffering, or the problem of suffering, how can suffering exist? You know, but what, one of the things that we learned in Surah Al-Kahf, you know, in the story of Khadr, is that Musa alayhi salam was witnessing Khadr do certain things that didn't make sense to him at the beginning. And then Khadr, he explained to Musa alayhi salam what they meant afterwards. When he killed the boy, when he built the wall, when he drilled a hole into the ship. And then he said, why are you doing all these things? He questioned him. And then Khadr explained to him afterwards what the hikmah was. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is wise, and He's knowledgeable, and He's Rahman, He's loving. Everything that He does has a wisdom. And everything that He does, there is knowledge behind it. We might not understand that. We might not understand that now, but later down the line, or at least in the Akhirah, we will understand it. So, this is another lesson from here. فَتَكُونَ لِلشَّيْطَانِ وَلِيًّا. Oh my dear father, if you don't follow me, you will be a friend of shaitan, you will be next to shaitan. You know, the greatest reward that any person can get is the wilayah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why Asiya, her great example, in her great dua, which has been repeated in the Qur'an, has been etched in the Qur'an, she said, رَبِّ بِنِي لِعِنْدَكَ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ. Oh my Lord, build for me a house in Jannah, next to you, عِنْدَكَ بَيْتًا فِي الْجَنَّةِ. وَنَجِّنِي مِنْ فِرْعَوْنَ وَعَمَلِي وَنَجِّنِي مِنْ قَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ. So she wanted the wilayah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is why she's the example, she's an example for the believers because of this dua. Because the wilayah of Allah, being a wali of Allah, is the greatest thing that you can be. And likewise, on the other hand, vice versa, the greatest, you know, punishment is to be far removed from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you are far removed from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you become a wali of shaitan, because he's the one who's been far removed. Al-Rajim, Al-Mal'oon, shaitan, you know, the one who was cursed by Allah, the one who was removed from Allah's rahmah, you know, and because of what he did. You know, so when you are removed from the rahmah of Allah, and you have the adab of Allah, you become close to shaitan, because you've been worshipping shaitan. And to be with the dirtiest, smelliest, you know, person is the worst punishment. فَتَكُونَ لِلشَّيْطَانِ وَلِيَّ. So, you know, here we see, these are four statements that Ibrahim says, and this is the last statement that he makes, where he speaks to his father in a very humble way, in a very nice way, without any arrogance, without any pride, no bad manner, sincerity for his father. And now let's see, contrast this with how his father speaks to him. Now look how his father speaks. And also contrast this with how Ibrahim speaks as a father to his son Ismail later on. Ya Bunay. You know, later on, Ibrahim alayhi salam sees that dream, and he, أَنِّي أَذْبَحُكَ يَا بُنَيَّ إِنِّي أَرَى فِي الْمَنَامِ أَنِّي أَذْبَحُكَ فَانْظُرْ مَاذَا تَرَى. Oh my dear son, I see in my dream that I am sacrificing you, tell me. So the word he uses is يَا بُنَيَّ. Oh my dear son. And this is a really good lesson to learn, you know, when people have children, the words that should be used are these, يَا بُنَيَّ. Oh my dear son, you know, and daughter, my dear daughter, my dear son. These are all the prophets, Luqman alayhi salam, this is the same thing he did when he spoke to his son. In the hikmah that he has in the Quran, he said, Ya Bunay, oh my dear son. But now look, let's see how Ibrahim's father, let's see how he says, Qala raghibun anta an alihati ya Ibrahim, la in lam tantahi la arjumannak wahjurni maliyya. He said, Do you dislike, do you hate my gods, O Ibrahim? If you do not stop, if you do not desist, لَأَرْجُمَنَّكْ, I will surely stone you to death. وَهْدُنِي مَلِيَا, and get lost, basically. وَهْدُنِي مَلِيَا, I don't want to see you, leave my sight, leave my presence, and go away for a long time or forever. Get away from me. So this is the language that, his father is speaking to him. So you can see the interplay between son and father. Here on the one hand is a son who cares about his father, who's sincere to his father, and uses the best, most loving language, you know, the most compassionate language. And then his father, so Ibrahim's an amazing son. And his father should have said, Ya Bunay, his father should have said that. His father should have said that. You know, if your child is coming to you with your best interest at heart, and this is what Ibrahim has. If your child comes to you, loving you, fully respecting you as a father or a mother, you should be, for number one, proud, and number two, happy. And number three, you should speak to that child in the best way. And Ibrahim, you saw how he kept on repeating, Ya Abati, Ya Abati. But the father, this is how he spoke. And the father didn't say Ya Bunay, number one. Number two, he didn't even say his name at the beginning.
الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات كانت لهم جنات الفردوس نزلا خالدين فيها لا يبغون عنها حولا قل لو كان البحر مدادا لكلمات ربي لنفد البحر قبل أن تنفد كلمات ربي ولو جئنا بمثله مددا قل إنما أنا بشر مثلكم يوحى إلي أنما إلهكم إله واحد فمن كان يرجو لقاء ربه فليعمل عملا صالحا ولا يشرك بعبادة ربه أحدا. الله أكبر. سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم ملك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا سمع الله لمن حمده. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر. الله أكبر.
Asr from tomorrow, Shona, quarter past five. Salat al-Asr from tomorrow, quarter past five. The reason why we get Asr because the last lecture in the university is 5 o'clock. To let as many students as we can to join the Jama'ah with us, Dhuhr and Asr as well. And the Asr will remain quarter past five for 2 months at least.
Thank you.
we were reading verse 46. قَالَ رَاضِبُ أَنْتَ عَنْ آلِهَتِ يَا إِبْرَاهِيمُ لَيْنْ لَمْ تَنْتَهِي لَأَرْجُمَنَّكَ وَأَرْجُمِي وَلِيَّا. So if we just look at the way this sentence is structured, it shows you that Ibrahim, the father Ibrahim alayhi salam, really was speaking to him in a harsh manner. Because in Arabic, the way to bring a sentence is that you start with what's called a mubtada, and then you bring what's called a khabar. And so that's the normal sentence structure in Arabic: mubtada and khabar. The mubtada is the predicate, and the khabar is the subject. I think that's what they call them in English. But here, Ibrahim's father, he swaps it around, you know. He reverses the sentence structure. And the reason is he wants to bring Ibrahim right at the end. And it reflects his psychology, you know. What's most important to him, what's dominant in his mind, is the fact that Ibrahim is against what he believes. So this is why he says, Araghibun. You know, he doesn't say anta raghibun. He says araghibun anta. Or araghibun anta an alihati Ibrahim. So he does that too, because it reflects the psychology that he doesn't even want to mention Ibrahim's name. He's not even interested in Ibrahim. What he's interested in is his gods. So this is one thing. And you know, the other thing that we see, Ibrahim's been telling him, look, these gods, they don't help you, they can't hear you, they can't see you, they can't benefit you.